environment and we're cool?
Well, it would have to be relaxed, even if it wasn't.
Even if it wasn't, exactly.
I'm in my hiking clothes.
Exactly, even if it wasn't. But I think this is so funny because when I first started the blab, there's supposed to be certain things sitting on the screen and I couldn't see them. So right. I had to call my my 17-year-old son and he did a little tech stuff in the background and he said, your screen was so big that you couldn't see everything else. And are you serious? That's all that it was the screen was enlarged.
Oh my God. Well, is it still, am I still very light?
You're still light, but a lot better than you were.
One second, let me just try to see if I can adjust this real quickly.
Okay.
Probably, I don't know. I don't want to take too much time to do that. I'm using the camera from the computer and not my other camera.
It's okay. It's not a problem. You go ahead and do a little bit of adjusting if you want to. But I just want to welcome everybody to the Y Project because there are a lot of people here who actually have never been on the Y Project. So I'm so grateful to you guys for deciding that you're going to stop by and spend the next hour with myself, Kristian Craige, and Sonia Barrett. Oh my goodness, I'm so excited to have her here.
Oh my gosh.
I just want to give a little bit of history as to what the Y Project is all about. I actually started this show only 6 weeks ago where I decided to create an environment where business owners could come together and discuss why they do what they do. The reason I did that is because in my recent past life, I was a business coach who assisted online womenpreneurs in their businesses. And a lot of times when I would ask the question to those women entrepreneurs why they did what they did, they didn't necessarily know the answer to that question. And I thought that was very interesting because from the foundation of my business, it had to be from a place of my understanding why I was doing what I was doing, that everything proceeded from there. So I decided I want to create an environment where people can come together or business owners can come together and talk about their why, which always revealed some core beliefs and core things that those business owners had either gone through that brought them to a certain point in their lives. We've just had some very, very interesting discussion. But in this case, Sonia Barrett, the reason I have invited you here, and I want to give a little bit of a background story. But you know what? Before we do that, Kristian. Kristian Craige is my co-host here. Kristian, meet Sonia Barrett. Sonia Barrett, meet Kristian Craige.
I hope you can see me. I can't get it adjusted in the shorter term.
You're fine. Okay. So before we get into the discussion, Kristian Craige sings us in and Kristian Craige also sings us back out. So before we get into the discussion, we're going to get into a little bit of jamming and loosening up here. So Kristian Craige, take us away.
Hi, everybody. How do I sound? Am I echoing on that screen?
You look good. You sound good and look good. You can hear him, Sonia?
Hey, you broke up a little bit. I can see him.
Okay.
But he broke up a little bit.
Okay.
I think everybody's Wi-Fi is just a little, you know, different. So, but right. That's the nature of live streams. So we're gonna deal with it, right?
Sounds good.
Absolutely. Everything's perfect. Like Jim Dow said.
Everything's perfect.
That's right.
So, I mean, just to be able to get to this platform where we can see each other live, you know, with all different things that are happening with technology. You know, it's beautiful that we can actually do this. So thank you for your sharing. Blessing your presence and energy. At least it's always good to see you. I know you're celebrating today. This is the month before. And I'm here with my mama Lloyd. She's tuned in with us. You can see her.
Yeah, Mama Lloyd, Kristian.
Hey.
Kristian.
Yes.
You're breaking up a little bit as you're talking.
How do I sound now? Still
Keep
breaking
talking.
Up? Am I still breaking up?
Probably farther away from the mic. He seems to be clearer.
How do I sound now? Does it sound better?
Yeah, I think the more you don't talk close to the mic, it's like, yeah, it doesn't break up. The further back you are.
Okay. Well,
right now I can hear you.
Okay.
Okay.
I turned the mic down completely and I'm just using the mic off the laptop.
Well, we'll have to work it out.
All right. So it's like an echo or is it breaking up?
Yeah, you're breaking up just a little bit, and someone in the chat is saying they can hear you breaking up.
Yeah.
Wow. Maybe.
I wonder if you refresh.
You know what I want to try?
Refresh your
own. Real quick. Give me a second.
Yeah, the headphones might work. That's the nature of
technology. And Sonia, yeah. Have you ever been on Blab before, Sonia?
Once, another interview. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Very good.
Okay, I got out my dog in here. Does that sound any good?
Yeah.
It sounds a little better, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, he goes in and out. That's what it is.
All right, so this is the microphone. And
okay, well, that was good.
That was good.
That sounded real good.
Yeah.
That was
all
good.
All right, we're making
much
progress.
Better. Barbara said much better.
Yeah.
Well, cool. While we're on the road, I'm going to start us off with a song. And we're just going to keep going with this live broadcast as we work it out. Here we go.
All right.
This is an original song that I wrote. And let me get this over here. Now we're good.
I'm jamming already.
And it's an original song I wrote called Keep Moving Forward.
I'm going to grab something.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I'm going to.
So far,
I'm just
so
going to grab something.
Yeah, go on and grab something. I was making a little matcha tea. Was actually matcha. And it's a green tea leaf that's grounded up into a. And it's totally replaced my coffee.
All right.
Yes. Gives me lots of energy and has lots of healthy properties. And I like to mix it in my water. So I'm going to sing us in. It's a song called Keep Moving Forward, if you can hear me.
We can hear you
now. Working early this morning, I couldn't get back in the bed. I got a whole lot of people counting on me to do just what I said. I might not have all the answers, but this I know for sure. I won't look back on past mistakes. A bright future is mine to make. This present moment I will take to move forward. Keep moving forward.
Oh,
I'm looking forward, yes I am, keep moving forward. To all my brothers and sisters, and everyone around the world, there's a new day evolving in front of us, our dreams they will unfurl. Everyone has a choice to reach up for. Love is here. I see the signs. I find my heart. The winning life is our time to move forward. Keep moving forward.
I'm looking forward. Yes, I am. Keep moving forward. Keep moving. Keep on moving. Don't stop. Oh, yeah. Here comes a new day. Keep on moving. Keep moving forward. And don't look back. Forward. Stay on track. Forward. Just be strong. Forward. You gotta hold on. Forward. Come on, let's make a way. Forward. For a better day, we don't have time to waste. We gotta make it better for the whole human race. Keep on, keep on. We move forward. Keep on, keep on. We move forward. Keep on moving on. Yeah, keep us stay strong. Every sound. Forward, keep on moving forward, forward.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Great voice.
I love the song. I love the melody.
Oh, thank you.
I love the words. The person singing
thank
it.
You.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Awesome.
So much.
Yeah.
Thank you. So much, Kristian. I love Kristian. He always sings us in and sings us back out. So it's an awesome, awesome, awesome thing. Sonia, I was going to give a little bit of a background story as to how I ended up finding you on the online. But for the sake of time, I'm gonna table that. If that comes up while you're talking, then I'll bring it up because we're only here until 8 o'clock.
No, so, I wanted to hear your story. First, okay.
Oh, you do? Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Okay. So about 2010, 2011, I had just made the decision. This is going to be a doozy. To exit the church. 2010, 2011.
Yeah.
Okay. I said it's going to be a doozy. and around that time, right when I made that decision to exit the church, and there's a lot of background to that. But what was happening, I'll give a little bit of background. What was happening was whenever I would read the Bible, I would get expansive information whenever I would read the Bible. Mm-hmm. But whenever I would go into the walls of the church, I got different information. It was not the same. It was shrunken down, for lack of a better way of saying it. So for myself, in order to exist in the specific church I was in at that time, I had made a decision that I was not going to allow the expansiveness that was coming to me. I had made a decision that I was going to shut that piece of Lisa down because whenever I go into these walls, something different occurs and it's conflicting with what I'm getting. So I had made a decision to shut that down until I decided I needed to wake that back up. And when I decided to wake that back up, it was like the flip of a light switch. The flip of a light switch. And out of the same two eyes that I have, I started to see things very, very differently. And I allowed myself to ask the innate questions that would rise up inside of me. And when I began to allow those questions to just rise up and begin to investigate the answer within myself, I just started to learn so much information, but also I would get online and I would investigate and see what was, you know, going on in the online space. And ultimately that led me to you because you were asking some some of the same exact questions that I was asking. And when I found you, so to speak, I said, oh my goodness. Because when you first start asking certain questions, and we'll get into those as you're talking, but when you first start asking certain questions, your perception may be that there's nobody else out there asking these types of questions, or nobody else out there necessarily exploring things in the way that you are. So at that time, I felt very alone at that time, and it was a very scary time, until I found you. You were one of the people that I found, and your book, wait a minute. The Holographic
Canvas.
This book, I would say that I literally carried this book in my pocketbook everywhere I went for an entire year. Because there was so much information that I was looking for that I understood within myself. So it was just like, a mirror reflection whenever I would, see the information. But I said, you have been a mentor in my life without you even necessarily knowing that since 2010, 2011. Yeah. And just recently I said, wait a minute, I have a show. I'm gonna reach out and ask her if she would like to come on and chit chat with the Y Project. And why didn't I think of this before? And I'm so grateful that you decided you would come and chat with us. And I'm gonna hand it over to you, Sonia, for you to introduce yourself to the Y Project and introduce yourself to the audience. Tell us who Sonia Barrett is.
I don't even know who she is. It's just easier. You read something that's on paper. Anyway, your story is not unusual. I hear that all the time, which we'll talk about. But that's a good question. It's kind of like asking me, what do I do? And somebody says, what do you do? I'm always like, what do you mean today? Like right now?
Right.
But Sonia Barrett, I don't know. I am, for lack of better words, right now I'm an author. I've written books. I read a lot of articles. I do lectures and conferences, and much of my work is, I guess, I don't even call it work, but much of what I speak about then is really based on my own curiosity and my own digging and my own wanting to sort of break through this perceived reality, then the way we perceive reality, my wanting to tap into something that is a space beyond this experience. And so that's what I share. That's what I talk about. That's me. That's what I'm about, this journey and understanding it more and more and more. To put it in a nutshell, I mean, as we talk, I guess there'll be, other things, but I'm known for speaking about the programming of humanity. I think everybody who knows my work is very familiar with that. And that was a very big thing for me, is the just sort of waking up one day and really realizing that, wait a second, my life and pretty much everybody's life is really just a combination or a compilation of ideas and concepts and beliefs created by other people, or someone else. And of course, not realizing how many layers deep this is. So, then you start asking the question. My question, it sounds very basic, but it was like, how do I even know I like this particular color just because I like it? Which I happen to not have a favorite color, incidentally. Now I get it. Whatever resonates with me in the moment, that's where I go. But I don't have a favorite color. But it was that kind of thinking. And then moving even further into that and realizing why people would be afraid of really asking that question. Because when you do that, for me at the time, what I realized is like you become almost like a blank slate. Now you're completely responsible for yourself. And
oh my goodness,
it's a scary thing for a lot of people, because now you're saying, I'm going off the grid, the social or the normal collective grid system. So now I'm responsible for myself. So this is where I'm coming from in the information that I share. And so that's what I talk about. I talk about what I talk about because that's the journey for me. And so that's where I am.
And I absolutely, Sonia, when you said the part about being coming to the place where you understand that you're completely responsible for yourself, that was one of those scary moments for me when I realized, oh my goodness, all this time I've been placing my responsibility and placing what happens in my life on something outside of myself. And one night I was sitting in the basement of my house with my husband, and I got this revelation, and it came in the form of a question, which often happens with me. Mm-hmm. Some huge, understanding coming in the form of a question. And the question was, what if the only reason that we're here is to come full circle back to ourselves?
Yeah, wow. That was,
and when I thought about that, I said, oh my goodness,
yeah.
what if all of this is about me understanding, really who I am, not just who I am, my name is Lisa Scott, but who am I? What is this being, that is functioning here on the face of the earth? And like today, I was sitting in the supermarket parking lot. My daughter was going in the supermarket, and I all of a sudden it felt like I became the observer of what I was watching. I'm sitting in the car and I'm watching people just, going in and out of the supermarket with their receipts and their carts and, just going back and forth. And what came over me was, wow, everybody knows exactly what to do. Everybody knows exactly how to do. It was like, it was drone-like. It right. was, everybody's right. going in and coming out, and they have their receipt and they have their cart and they have, it was just, it's amazing when that happens.
Right.
Because you're like, what is, what's going on,
Yeah. It's a program just sort of.
Go ahead. What were you going to say?
Me? No, I was just saying it, the program, you start to observe the program in effect. Where everybody is operating on the blueprint, the collective blueprint, and most people not realizing it. That's the norm. You're doing all of the normal, what quote unquote normal things. But what you had was that stepping back, and for moments, and I think a lot of people have that moment where there's suddenly this flash. There's this moment of incredible clarity that happens sporadically. And you see things, you almost, yes. almost like you are, as you said, the observer, you're standing back suddenly, and it's like you're watching a movie. And every now and then you get these bursts of clarity, and you're watching everybody. And that there was a chapter in the book, and of course I haven't picked up the Holographic Canvas in a while, but I forgot the name of the chapter. There's a chapter in the book. What the heck is the name of that chapter? Oh my gosh. Anyway, there was one particular chapter that I wrote, and it was based on my experience very similar to that. I was sitting by the beach, and I was writing, because I would go by the beach and I would sit and I was writing. And in that moment, I was watching people, older people walking with canes. And in that moment, it was such an incredible fascination for just the observation of these beings. And in that moment, I just had this incredible love that came over me for all these people, the human race. It's like I saw it from a completely different space. And it was an excitement about the human experience. That's what I was really suddenly alerted to. And it was a human experience where somebody comes in and they've played a role. And then now they're playing a character of being old. And that's what I was seeing. I'm like, they don't realize who they are. So they're on this stage performing, and they're going through the whole idea of time, even though it doesn't exist. And it didn't matter, fat, skinny, old, young. It was just this profound feeling. And it was like they were all me on another level. They were all aspects of me, of this greater essence. And I actually, and then I was listening to India Irie song at the time, and she was actually singing about music. You're always in my head. I don't know if you know that song, but a great song. You would love it to play a guitar, but that song, when you listen to the words, are you familiar with the song?
Her favorite song is Strength, Courage, and Wisdom. I haven't heard a lot of her songs, and I am my hair.
This one is You're Always in My Head. Okay. But she was thinking about music. But you had to really listen to realize what she was talking about. And for some reason, the harmonics in the song, because a lot of times, as you know, music, the tones, the everything about it just sort of integrated with where my brain was and that space at the time. And it was just so incredible. And I just kept writing. And that was how that chapter came about. And a lot of the book I wrote over a period of my own really waking up and really moving forward. But then things got rewritten. As I grew, the book changed. And there was some other thing I was going to tell you about that. But as I went along and I started to understand more, the book started to change. So I wrote they were almost like articles. I wrote them, and I didn't know I was writing a book. So over time, it was one day, it was like, I think I have a book. So that's kind of what happened, and I started putting it together. And as I did that, I was then sort of guided by my own more expansive self to go here, look this up, pull that. I needed to support what I knew, what I was saying. So those references that came, it wasn't because I sat and did like major research. I was really that part of me just go, okay, well, you need to say this thing, but you need to back it up. So go here and pick this. So I probably didn't even read the whole book, but I just was directed to go right there, pick that information, and put it in. And that's basically what happened with that book. And so when you talk about it, it's interesting, because if you ever come to a live workshop, especially a few years back, people's books, they would travel with it. They're marked, they're highlighted through and through. They're like dog ears on the books. They've carried it. And it, to me, is just so fascinating, because I had no idea. I just was like, done. I'm like, okay. I just need to get this done and out. I don't care if anybody reads it. You know, I was done. I was going through a transition in my life after saying I was completely done now with that area of the work world. I had left corporate America, but I'd gone to do consulting for somebody in the industry, the Hollywood industry, and ended up being there longer than I thought, doing more than I thought. So I decided, I'm like, you know what? I'm done. The first one I was done because I was getting comfortable with getting a regular paycheck. And that's always so funny when I say that to people, you know, but I was like, you know what? You're starting to get comfortable with getting a check all the time. It's time to quit. It's time to quit this job.
Wow.
So I did that one. Won't go into that one, but yeah, I didn't know how I was going to do it, whatever. But you know what? At the time, I was committed to quitting. So I'm like, well, don't like sleeping in my car, but how badly do you not want to be here? Well, so bad that I could camp out in my car. That's how much I don't want to come in here anymore.
Wow.
So, so then moving past that, so I ended up in this other space, and then it was time to leave there again. It was okay. I'm like, I asked for some comfort, some relaxation. I asked for a period of time where everything was great. I, you know, got to do all these things. The money was just flowing. And then I was like, okay, I got a break. Boom, I'm ready to move it up, step it up again now in awareness. Of course, then my whole everything now, I had to give up my condo. I was damn near also ready to pitch a tent up in the mountains. I had a tent in the back of my car. I'm like, you know what? I called Goodwill. You know, they came and picked up a lot of my clothes. I couldn't sell, and I wasn't supposed to, I guess, my furniture. I ended up having to put it in storage. But the bottom line of it was this new beginning for me. And so anyway, to cut a long story short, I ended up moving to be in a temporary space, be there just for a couple of weeks. And that was like 9 years ago, and so now we're married.
Wow. So,
I mean, it's been 12 years, but I'm only going to be here 2 weeks, 9 years later.
So I
move. I give up everything. I have nothing. I run out of money. I run out of money. Like, I find a quarter and I'm happy, kind of run out of money. I'm like, 25 cents. I'm like, oh my God, great 25 cents.
Wow.
So it was this whole process, and I had the book, and I'm like, you know what? Something kept saying, you know what? If you finish this book, you will have closed a chapter in your life and move forward. I'm like, oh, okay. Let me just finish this thing, because I saw the symbology of it, closure. Bring it to a close, because the book represented so much of my transition, my awakening, that I needed to actually, the book represented that chapter to close it. And so I didn't know how to do a lay out a book. It's a little bit easier now with so much on the internet, but I didn't know how to do any of that. And I had to get on the internet then, try to figure it out. And I was literally in tears a couple of the times, because like I can't do this. This is like too hard. I can't do it.
Wow.
And so went through that. Didn't have the money to even get the ISBN number. Like, you know. And then a friend of mine, she's like, "You really need to get that book done. You need to get it out." And so there was some kind of deal at the time happening. And then I get a gift card in the mail from her. She's like, "Get your ISBN number." I'm like, oh, so that's what happened. So I went ahead and got the ISBN number, and I'm like, okay, good, boom. This is, got to get it done, got it printed, cover changed. Even that changed. Had thought I had a cover, and something said to me, no, that's not the cover. I'm like so mad now, because I'm like, oh, I'm getting it printed, it's done. It's like, no, it has holographic in there. I'm like, holographic what? So a couple days of like trying to be on that, but I don't even know what that means. And then Canvas came. And so it was a holographic canvas. And so I got the name changed on it, the cover changed. And the second part of it, that was a little bit after that, my son said to me, when I said, somebody said I need a tagline. And he said, real casual, diffusing of mind and matter. Why'd you just put that? I'm like, whoa, okay.
That's a deep tagline. That's deep.
That's what it is. He's like, diffusing of mind and matter. I'm like, okay, that's what it is. And so it was interesting how it all came together, and the holographic, and then the canvas, you know. And I didn't even think I realized the deepest part in terms of what the canvas, you know, this canvas that we're creating life on. So anyway, so that's how that part of my life happened, with the book and talking, and then one thing led to another. And this person said, you know, you got to check out what Sonia's talking about. And it just kind of happened from there. So that's how that part happened.
Wow. Because you know what? I picked up the book today, right? Because I'm like, what am I going to ask Sonia? I have so many questions. Mm-hmm. And anything that I read out of this book, we could have an hour-long conversation on. But I do want to refresh your memory about the chapter called The Programming of Humanity.
Okay. So, tell me about it, Lisa.
I'm going to read it to you. I'm going to read some of this.
Tell me about it.
So you said, or your question was, is life a dream? Where are we really? When we sleep at night, our dreams seem so real. They seem as real as our waking reality. How can we confirm that this is not the dream and that what we perceive as the dream is not reality? Or is existence narrowed down to an assortment of dreams? Again, I ask, where are we? Who and what are we? Illusion after illusion, a maddening labyrinth as we jump through time, unaware of the expansiveness of our being as it far exceeds a linear existence. Wait 1 minute, I'm gonna read one more paragraph. We build schools to educate and to encourage the concept of class division determined by education and monetary status. Fraternities, sororities, Ivy League schools, initiates are selected based on a guideline of formulas designed to determine the best of the best, such as assessment clearly automatically creates, or such an assessment clearly automatically creates mental distortions, pushing us even further away from a state of oneness. We have descended into a deeper state of division. It is unfortunate that tragedy has most often been the force that brings unity, yet shortly after we return to an attitude of division. It is the mind that remains marinated in social codes. It is the mind that provides the dream for the reality embraced as humanity's ultimate waking existence. The seekers of truth appear to be more heavily submerged in illusion and deception. Cosmic tales are spun as power is relinquished to those held in a perception of greatness and worthiness. We diminish our potential and worthiness by elevating particular humans who may appear to have transcended the human veil, many of whom have left behind words of wisdom, yet the meaning is most often lost or misunderstood. And I'll stop there to see if you know, what comes up for you as you, as I reread what...
You wrote that. You know, there are times when I have done that where I picked it. I'm like, wow, I wrote this stuff. Yeah. You know, because there's, you know, I wrote from like this whole other space when I was writing a lot of that stuff. It was interesting. I was in a lot of, I guess what I now realize is Einstein mode. When I say Einstein, is the fact that Einstein, I guess, used to do that thing where he would be between sleep and wake, that in between stage, and he would get a lot of answers. But see, I didn't know any of that then, but that's what I used to do.
Yeah.
I could go and lay down. I'd have a question. I could go and lay down, and I would be in that in between state, and I could get just a flood of information.
Yes.
Now, we could consider that, I'm gonna answer your question, but we tend to consider that mystical. You know, it's like, woo, you know, you're going and you're getting in touch with the ascended masters or whoever. But see, what I came to realize is that it wasn't any of that. It's like, it's just a natural course of our connection. We are naturally linked into everything. because everything is made up of information. And that was like the most profound thing I realized, is that it's all data. So you now hear scientists talking about it. It's all bits of information, like a computer. So basically what I ended up at the time, as part of me learning how to tap into it, all of it, I would go and I would feel this intense energy come over me. But what was happening is I was shifting my awareness then. I was shifting into a space to tap into information that was simply on another frequency. It was just on a different frequency than this one where we operate. I mean, scientifically. So yes, I tend to look at a lot of things more. When I say scientific, sometimes people get that confused with thinking that I'm just talking, that everything is based on our basic science. When I use the term science, I am incorporating some of the wonderful explanations that our scientists have come up with. But at the same time, there is a science that far exceeds any words that we could ever use, because there's a point where you cannot explain it. That is the powerful point. Try as we will, there are no words. But what we can do is we can feel and be that understanding, even though we can't put it into words. But in writing that chapter, now I have to remember what the heck the chapter was now. We're talking about people surrendering. What I remember is realizing how we surrender our being, our everything, over to our ministers, our anybody that supposedly is considered in more an authority than us. The fact that we are programmed to believe that we are not we're not capable of being responsible for ourselves or capable of making our own decisions, that someone or something else outside of us knows more of what's best for us. And that's why we have the Savior program. So right off the bat, that chapter brings that into realization. And so we do that with the idea of the ascended masters. We don't realize that everything that we see here, our corporate structure, our whole hierarchical system, is based on something else. And I know that's not what this show is about, but you know, there's a whole lot more to explain on that. But it's based on a much bigger system, other principles. We look at anything that appears to be outside of this space, as we know Earth life to be, where it seems that they might have more power or more abilities, as suddenly being greater than we are. And so that's why we cling to, instead of maybe looking at the information and how can we utilize that information, instead we attach to anybody or any force that seems to be more magical or mystical, and we lose ourselves in that. Hence, confusion of the idea of God, and in the church, you're not worthy. You're always down here. Yet in the Bible, you know, there's a couple of spots there where, you know, it says ye are gods, and you know, even in Yeshua's scriptures with Yeshua. And I always say to people, before you go, well, I don't know if Jesus existed, I'm like, you know what? You're getting lost here, because that's not the point. The point is somebody wrote that stuff and it was based on something. Whether we know clearly or not, it was based on something. And the greater works than these shall ye do. Now you show this man supposedly doing, you know, mystical things, as we call it, or turning water into wine, or things that really are, for, you know, the most part, really scientific. But we, here it is, they say greater works. He says greater works than these shall ye do. For me at the time, since I still had some church in me, some of my religious background, back then, back in 1992, that was a driving point for me. The greater works than these shall ye do thing led me to this moment. That concept of the greater works then these shall ye do. And I'm like, well, I can still show you my Bible. I still have it in there all marked up, going through it and then putting it aside. I'm like, okay. But it was like, okay, so if supposedly this individual did all this stuff, and then they're saying greater works than these shall ye do, well, then what the heck are these greater works? How do I go about doing these greater works? So that's what I'm interested in. I want to work magic. I want to just, you know, and as a kid, it was like, well, how does God get to be God? I want to do that. That was my thing. It's like, so I'm thinking in my little head, like, I want to do that. And why is he so mean? Why is he like, will strike you down and all this crazy stuff? You know, so all that stuff just didn't add up to me, you know, scaring you, you know, Jesus can come like a thief in the night, have me freaked out. Like if I didn't behave, that Jesus may come in the night, my parents are gone and I'm still here. So all stressed, I would be all stressed out. It wasn't a good day today. If I go to sleep, am I going to get up by myself?
Oh my goodness.
But anyway, but that whole greater works, you know, say what you will. Yeah, the church has got its madness and its nonsense. But you know where the place I come from is, I'm all about extracting information that aligns. I don't have time to do battle with, okay, well, who was right? Yahshua wasn't here, all they're lying. Because you know what? At the end of the day, that's the human game you're talking about. What I'm talking about is ascending into myself, into the greater aspect of who I am. Yes. So I don't really spend time on all of that. The whole game to me is fascinating. It's just a matter of where you choose to be and choose to place your focus. I chose not to place my focus on becoming any one thing. No, I am not going to be a Wiccan. Traveled there, looked, checked it out. I don't want to get a robe. And I don't want to do that. I just want to see what you do, which is what I did. Right. Why are they afraid of witchcraft? You know, oh, well, let me see what they do. So I go and I see what they do. And I learned a lot about nature. Their whole thing was not taking people's choices. So it was great. So I learned a lot as I go along. So I'm saying all that as that chapter really is based on everything that I'm saying. It is the whole programming of what we think we are, and our for some people inability to accept or own that maybe you might be more, and maybe you are completely worthy of tapping into that. Maybe you can tap into it because it is your birthright. So that's where I'm coming from in terms of, yeah, that chapter.
And speaking about birthright and birth age, I gotta ask this question, Sonia, because this was another thing that I, you know, another one of those questions that came up for me, you know, intuitively, innately, I don't know, but I started to question, just like you, the death program.
Oh, yeah.
we have to talk about this and you know, yeah, just hit it. Maybe we're gonna hit it and you know, whatever. But just like any other program,
yeah,
I began to question that program. Yeah. I wondered what is this, you know, because when I sit back of my own individual self, and I try to perceive of death, mm-hmm, I cannot perceive of it.
Right.
I can't.
I understand.
The only thing that I understand is that outside of me, that person over there, mm-hmm, something occurred with that person and I saw that they, you know, had that experience.
Right.
But within myself, I cannot perceive of it.
Yeah.
So when I felt that feeling, I thought, Well, what is this? Why is it that if I sit here and I try to perceive of this thing that I'm being told absolutely must occur, why can't I perceive of it if it's something that I'm that I'm supposed to be connected to? So can you just touch on that? I know we supposedly only have 5 minutes, but we're going to go as long as as we go. But yeah. Can we talk about that a little bit?
You know, yeah, you know what? I came in to this life with that realization that there was something off about it. So for me, coming in, I just really thought it was just bizarre, because you've heard me say that. It was, you know, I always refer to it as a big airport with arrivals and departures. You know, people coming and going. And I'm just like, does anybody notice that this is weird? This is it's such a bizarre thing to me. I understand, you know, basically what happens. But yes, like everything else, this is what just amazes me. Like everything else, it's all programs. It's all programs. Yes, programs that have now gotten written in, no differently than you write a computer code, written into our DNA, written into the fabric of our genetic bloodlines, our gene pool, the human gene pool, all bits of information written in. And I tell you what's even more fascinating, you know, in the last several years, first it seemed like I was crazy, but now it's all coming up. There's more talk about it. But I was going to tell you something that was, what's fascinating is the fact that scientists talk about adaptation. To me, that is a profound piece of knowledge that people need to really understand, that human beings are so pliable that we adapt. We have adapted to whatever evolution was essential on the planet throughout these various timelines, civilizations. We have adapted down to the very physical transformation of the body. Now, if somebody can get that in their head, that we adapt, the brain takes the request, basically, in a way, from the being, the individual, which then becomes a collective desire. And one of the things to make that even clearer is maybe a civilization where they're running from dinosaurs and their legs are shorter. I mean, they could, over time, they start wishing their legs were longer to run faster. And over time, the body starts to then make changes that are necessary for survival. You know, we did to my knowledge, at one point, we didn't have rib cage to protect the lungs. As the environment changed, there were things that became necessary that the body took on. There are organs that supposedly, like the appendix, supposedly that aren't really used anymore. There's so many things when you research it that we have changed as a species in different cultures, different parts of the world, in order to adapt to the environment, adapt to environmental changes. And so with realizing the plastic nature of the brain of human beings, you also start to be able to realize how easy it is to program a particular belief over time, and it becomes the accepted, it becomes the norm. What will happen in 20 years from now? All the kids that are born now will never know anything about a rotary phone. They will not know much about a lot of that stuff, but guess what? It will not be part of their reality. The only reality that they will be aware of is anything within that 20 year and beyond, that span of time of their existence, and pieces of history, which will get distorted. And so their lives will be shaped based on these certain components, this change that's happening. Just like with the cyberspace, the whole computer world, everything being online, all the changes that are taking place in our brains right now, which I just did a little talk on that podcast, but all of the changes taking place in us is changing us. It's so subtle. It is gradualism. We are gradually changing as a species according to technology, according to all these various supposed advancements. And the generations that come after will already be wired in. They will be already be networked into it. They won't know what we were before. They won't know what it was like to stop to use a payphone or to never have a million emergencies because you have no cell phone. So therefore you just waited till you got home and there was no voicemail. So people couldn't get a hold of you. They called you when they called you. There was less emergencies. You see, they won't know any of that. What they will know is what they know now. And so it is continuously for all of us. We don't remember what we were because that information has gotten distorted. So all we now know is death, that people die. Mm-hmm. Was that the case always? They don't question that because science is to some degree only able to trace, there's certain aspects of history based on how they're doing the tracing. Now they're starting to pick it up a little bit because they're starting to examine the organism a little bit deeper and not just carbon dating and you know, topical things, but checking out the body and the DNA and realizing, well, wait a second, this is not junk DNA. Mm-hmm. What if that part has tremendous information, like a computer, mm-hmm. all the data necessary for human beings to go back to this more expansive level of evolution, or what I like to call the superhuman being? What if, and it was shut down for whatever period of time because of whatever the adaptation was, what if that is the case? Suddenly we don't see it. But suddenly now, because of the evolution in technology has everything to do, it aligns with the potential evolution of human beings. We just don't understand it. Exactly. We think technology, oh, you know, okay, well, this stuff is just happening and they're coming up with things. You align yourself because just as technology is booming, this is technology. This vehicle is technology. You have to know how to turn it on. It's not activated. It's very automated right now. So we've been living in these automated vehicles that's been taking information or taking instructions from a robotic mind, a mind that operates based on lots of pre-recorded information, lots of old information, lots of preset information, lots of old patterns. That's what we're operating by. But now you're hearing, like even Bill Gates, and I forgot who he's involved with, they're putting money into research for immortality. So inside of us as human beings, the information, there's something in us that is telling us that we don't really have to do that. We're trying to remember how not to do that, but there's something in us, and that's why you're going to hear more about it. You're going to start seeing more of that kind of information coming up. 10 years ago, 9 years ago, when I came out and I was talking about that, it was in the book. Very few people, you didn't really hear that being talked about, but now it's coming to the forefront because, yes, it is an opportunity to begin to see more and understand more. And with women and their menstrual cycle and menopause, that was something I looked at as well. And in all the research that I've done, I've looked into, science is looking at that too, that it was adaptation. Mm-hmm. That was not something that was necessarily essential, but somehow there was reasons. I can't go into all of that now either, but why the female, the human female, started to adapt this particular way. And the reason why menopause becomes significant is because of the shutting down process, the hormones, and the aging process that happens because that starts to get shut down. Yeah. And men, it happens too, but somehow a little bit later, but because of our reproductive system and, you know, us getting pregnant and giving birth, I think it all has to do with that. When I looked into it within myself and tapped into the greater bit of information, I realized that menopause is really a survival program. And that's all I can say about it. And one day I hope to be able to talk about it in a bigger way. But it is a survival program. Much of our programs are based on survival for whatever that may be. And survival in this case, yes, well, you can't keep having children according to the environment at that time, according to the society as well. And because we're all plugged into this, there's various kinds of morphogenic fields where, like the female morphogenic field across the planet, we all have, are sort of tied into a particular frequency that represents the female frequency, which is the negative and then the positive. So it's male and female is positive and negative frequencies, not as in bad, but as in frequency itself. And so we're all tied into this these fields, and we sort of pick up some of the information, the collective programs, and that's one way how it sort of passes through and through. But as we wake up and we start to understand more about all of this, we start to change our own thinking. As we start changing our own thinking, not just because we're being positive, but because you start to get it. You start to understand the science of it. You start to understand why this is not necessary. Then there's that, and your brain says, oh, okay, so we're not doing that. So now all the changes, the brain starts working on you with whatever changes that needs to happen in your body and all your belief systems and all your issues and challenges that you've held on to. That's what's aging you. That's what's taking you down. It becomes like gravity. So all of those things need to be released. You start understanding all of this. You start to just let it go because they all carry a frequency. It's all energy based, and the body is designed like that, where it records information. We're transmitters and receivers. So we record information, and information gets recorded in our being, in our cells, and so on. And it can anchor us down. So it's a whole process of understanding, I think, that needs to happen. And a person needs to want to understand that. You know, we can talk all day. They need to want to understand that. Somebody says, oh, I don't want to live that long. Well, the only reason why you don't want to is because you see living that long, you reference the world as is. That's what you're using as your reference. But what if, as you live and as you evolve, you become part of a different space? What if your evolution is continuously taking you into a space that is relevant to your ongoing evolution and transformation into, you know, yet more expansive levels? What if that's what's going on? But see, people don't think that. They look at their reference point, which is the external reality, and then they say, oh, yeah, no, if it's going to be like this, no. You have to understand that we are constantly evolving into different levels. You see it. Everybody, you see it. Look back 5, 10, 20 years. We don't get that. Look at what life was 20 years ago, maybe. Look at how you've grown. You've changed. You don't even remember that you used to know like 100 people. You forget about them. You don't even remember that they existed because you have grown into a different reality, a reality in which those people no longer have supporting content or interaction relevant to who you are right now. That's why they fall away. They fall away. And so it goes on and on and on. So that in itself will let you know that no, it doesn't mean that you're going to live forever and be in this, whatever you want, how you ever want to look at it. But there is definite greater level of evolution. And it's not just about just living a long time. It is an opportunity for us to be here to expand into greater and greater levels of reality, hence allowing us to enter other spaces, other possibilities, other dimensional spaces. And that's really what's happening. So it's not just about hanging on because we don't want to die. It's not about that. It's an opportunity to transcend the human game as we have been experiencing the game.
Woo! Oh my goodness. I love when you talked about the fact that this is not just about positive thinking. It's about understanding ourselves on a scientific level. I've never felt more positive than understanding, you know, the certain inner workings of myself.
Yeah.
Once I understand that, I actually don't have to do positive thinking anymore.
It's so much easier. Because you're not trying to convince yourself. You're
exactly.
Trying to convince yourself. You see the formula. You get it. It's a, oh, I get. And that's what I try to explain to people. It's not about memorizing stuff. There's nothing to do with that. It's not about that. I, you know, people ask me a lot of times, oh, I heard you talking about such and such. Have you read this? No, I haven't. I haven't. I don't know most of the people that they ask me if, you know, about, okay, well, they wrote such and such. I don't know. But what I do know is that I can get that information anytime because it's in the oxygen, it's in everything, and I can just tap into it. Even if I don't know it, you ask me, it's right in that 2 seconds, I download. So,
I love it.
You know, like the Matrix, a helicopter program. Shoot, I'm like, yeah, download. That's what I'm talking about. That's the same thing. You just boom, it's on, you tap in. And as you get stronger, as I get stronger with what I know, yes, the more I'm able to tap in, do more, and then you don't feel like reality's choking you so much, you know? Because that's how most people feel. Because it's tough. This ain't no cakewalk.
That's right.
Being in this reality ain't no cakewalk. It's a butt kicker. I'm not lying. Yeah. It's a butt kicker. And I have days where I'm just like, you know what? I am just done today. Yeah. I am just done today. So, and that's okay. And you allow yourself. You don't have to be up positive all the time. And, you know, what's going on, you know, sister and goddess and whatever. I'm like, I don't want to hear any of it. Right now, this is what I'm feeling. And I am allowing that feeling to happen. And I am good with it. And I don't need to cover up for anybody. This is how I'm feeling. And I'm going to let it move through and pass. That's it. You don't have to be anything for anybody. That is the trick. That is what will hang you up every time.
Oh yeah. I tried it. I know it's
has. Everybody has. It's the mask. It's part of what you do. You are taught to put a mask on. That's what you do. You put a mask on and try to adhere to the regular human programs. Everybody has done it. And then you realize, you know, it's like, this stuff just wears me out. It's just tiring. I can't do this, you know. And then you do that surrender, and you just realize everybody has their journey, and everybody's going through it. You don't have to be anything for anybody.
Yeah. And when we come to that place, oh my goodness, the weight that is taken off your shoulders understand that, and you get, I mean, I just recently started coming into that space, you know, of wow, it's, I don't have to, you know, walk around with the law of attraction and having a purpose and all of this stuff that, you know, is the buzz phrasing of today. I can just be me.
Don't forget the abundance message, the what is that? There's the abundance message. There's purpose and abundance, though. It's like everybody's got to get out and be on it about getting their abundance on. And I mean, it's just people are so like worn out on it. It's just too much.
Yeah,
I'm like, it's just too much. You know, you can have all and be all of that without having to adhere to a lot of these things that put pressure on people. I'm all about people not putting pressure on themselves like that. So
yeah. Sonia, you have given us so much to ponder and think about, and I'm so grateful that I press record, that I remember to press record, so that anybody who is here, or if you have any friends or anybody you want to hear this show, we are definitely going to be providing a link for the Y Project. I'm going to put it in the Facebook invite that I originally created. And of course, on my different pages, I love to share especially information like this, because not a lot of people get a chance to hear this type. I mean, Sonia, you have your you know, you've been writing books and talking about this stuff for years. So there's people that have been exposed to you for years, but there's also that many more who have not been exposed at all. So I can't wait to share this information.
Yeah. It has been, for some people, it's a little jolting.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I understand.
It's a little jolting. They're like, well, you're a little jolting. But you know, I've had people say that, and then they come back years later, and they go, man, it's like I wasn't ready because it was just too much. And then now, you know, they find me on YouTube, and then I don't know, they're following me for like years. Like the workshop I had at my house in February, you know, like one of the ladies that came, she had been following my stuff for like 4 years. And then finally, she was ready to make contact. So it's always wonderful, whatever. Yeah.
And that's the awesome thing about technology, because I've been stalking you for years, Sonia. But I'm the one. I mean, every YouTube video, I'm a part of your membership, the Daily Reboot, and I love it.
Yes.
I love the daily reboot. I feel like I'm getting the benefit of the fresh thoughts that you're getting as soon as you wake up from that in-between space that you were talking about earlier. So
yeah, it could be anything, you know? It could be anything. I'll come up with the, you know, just the wildest thought. But anyway, but I share it.
But that's what I love. That's what I love about you, because you're not afraid to explore and share the information. So I just want to thank you so much for being here with the Why Project, Sonia. I'm going to ask.
Well, let me make sure we give out the website.
Yes.
Let me make sure.
All of your information. Tell them everything.
It's therealsoniabarrett.com. I changed the name to therealsoniabarrett.com because there's another Sonia Barrett. So therealsoniabarrett.com. And that's where they can find pretty much anything on me. And YouTube. You can always just Google my name, though, and I come up. There's tons and tons of interviews, but YouTube has a lot, and I'm really preparing to try to do more. Like, yeah, at least once a week, try to put up a video, because people really love it. And I know we have to go, but what I love, though, is the fact that when I get an email from somebody who just was able to take that deep breath because they were feeling pressured. And then that moment, I'm like, you know what? It's okay if you don't feel like motivated sometimes. It's okay. You don't have to be motivated or interested sometimes. And it's like, oh, thank you. And so that is what feels good, because I know how that feels. So it's therealsoniabarrett.com, and my podcast is soniaunplugged.com, but it's all on the on that website as well.
And Sonia, I don't care if we stay here all night, to tell you the truth. If everybody knows, the Why Project is from 7 to 8. If you decide you want to unplug from this conversation, you are welcome to do so. But I'm not trying to rush nobody. I was trying to shorten it up because I thought you had to go. But we can sit here. I don't care nothing about that. So if anybody needs to go, I'll see you later. And thank you for joining. But we can keep right on talking. And
this is powerful. Talking about this stuff is like so amazing. It's so fascinating to me. I hope one of these days you get to come to the live stuff.
One of these days
we have so much fun. And sometimes, you know, like the last one when we did Mount Shasta. Yeah, we taped it, but we were like, you know what, we can't put this on the internet. We can't put this out. Because everybody comes and they're able to just talk and express totally how they feel about the game. And we laugh at things where people would just take it seriously. Well, that's serious. Well, we break it down, because laughter is it's a good part of that magic. It is like that magic wand that decrystallizes reality. When you're able to laugh, it makes the thing not that real anymore. But when you take it seriously, man, it is on. It is on and in front of you, as my friend would say, Patrick, it's on and cracking.
It's on. Oh my goodness, I so agree with that. It wasn't until I started not taking things so seriously that I was able to loosen up about life and, you know, have more of a good time and receive more information. And Kristian, I just want to ask you, if you have to go, you're welcome to go. If you want to sing us out, you can do that. But I don't want to cut Sonia off. If she's, I got you here. I'm not trying to let you go. Listen.
Oh God. Yeah. Kristian,
Did you have any questions for Sonia or anything, any comments, anything you want to say? Because I know you do. You might have to go.
Well, you know, I'm good right now, and I'm enjoying the conversation. And I do have a couple of questions because, Sonia, I'm finishing up a book right now, and I'm kind of just letting the spirit lead me. And in terms of linear time, how long did it take you to do that? That was your first book, right? The Holographic Canvas, right?
10 years. 10 years.
Thank you. And I appreciate you saying that because you did something from the heart and you followed the messages and, you know, if it was to change the title, you can let it come to you. And that's how it's been with my book. I probably have been writing in it for years, five, but I've been thinking about it about 4 or 5 years. It's a book that I'm writing for my sons. If I passed away or transition, you know, anytime before, you know, even tomorrow, that I would have something that they could read and just kind of get an idea of how I was programmed. But I love everything you're saying. I can tell you're touching a lot of profound things. And, you know, again, that was one of my biggest questions, how long that book took, because a lot of people that I know who know about my book, they're saying, well, why don't you just go to Amazon and read how to do a book in 30 days? And I'm like, but that's not what I'm trying to do. This is for what? It's for my son. I'm not trying to rush it out there just to say I have a book. It has to say something, right? At least say what's on my heart.
Right. Yeah.
And so I appreciate how you talk from your heart. I appreciate how you're open. I mean, you're an instructor like Lisa. You're easy to comprehend. You don't try to lose folks with education or knowledge or how much you know. I could tell your mission is to connect. And when you're open and you just want to connect, you let things flow through you so that you can do that. Because like you said, the voices are always talking to us. Like you said, in the Matrix, and you can download a program, how to fly a helicopter, how to do whatever. We're already connected. All the answers are inside already. So whatever we need, yes, we can grab it. And our body is changing. We're moving out of this age of Pisces into the age of Aquarius. And, you know, our bodies are metamorphing right now. I mean, we're crystallizing as we speak, and it just feels great. You know, and the more we're aware of what's going on, especially in this computer age, like you said, we're adapting. Our children are adapting. They don't know about rotary phones and different things that we did. I mean, they're gonna come in a world where cars are driving themselves. You know, you get one of the Teslas, and you'll be driving yourself. So, again, I'm just amazed at everything you have to say. I know we usually try to keep it to a timeline of an hour, but I'm good at least to 8. I just want you to know I'm here enjoying the conversation. Definitely want to follow you. I thank Lisa for inviting you. I do want to stay in touch because you know, you are definitely speaking my language, so I appreciate you.
You're welcome. And just write your book. Just write it. Don't write it based on, you know, leaving it behind or in case you passed. Just write. Just write. When you feel inspired, you write down. That's what I did. Just write. I did that with the second book. I didn't sit and just, I'm going to write a book. That's just, it's just too much for me. Because I don't want to write from my head. So you just, allow yourself, because you're growing with your book. That's what's happening. When we're writing, you know, it's really about you. It's really about you. And if you go and you read your book and you make changes, you'll see that you've been documenting your own transformation as you've gone along. And so you might find that a few years later, oh, I want to change this because this is who you are now. And when that moment comes where there becomes like a more settled or more foundational you, more whatever, centered you, and the information you write becomes, oh, okay, that can go. Because it's now becomes this more of this platform, this springboard. That's why sometimes it takes so long, because you're changing. And so the content kind of changes until you get to that area, that moment where it's now a launch pad and there's nothing else to change. Even though you will transcend the book, you will grow into a more expansive you. So that's what I have to say. Don't think any of that other stuff. Just be here. Just be here and write when you feel it.
And another thing I wanted to mention too, how you said life seemed like a major airport where you see people kind of flying in and flying out. And I always use that analogy because I said, you know, we are at an airport and we fly in, our spirits fly in, and then we go to spiritual rental and we get our bodies and then we get into this compartment that we're in. But we're renting this body. It's on leave. We can't keep it. You know, so just like if you're visiting a town and you get a rental car, what do you have to do? You have to bring it back to that airport. You drop that body off.
Unless you buy it, you know, like mine is paid for. I'm like the transformer, you know, it'll like transform. You know, the cars of transformers, you know, you can change. That's what I have. I have one of those bodies that just like will transform.
I'm loving it. I'm loving it. Absolutely.
Oh yeah. God. Yeah, this
I love it. And I'm just gonna I'm going to stop the recording and just say to everyone who has been here on the Why Project that we're here each and every Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. This is Sonia Barrett, who is with us this evening. She's author of many books, but the book that I started with was The Holographic Canvas. And Sonia has also shared her websites and all of that. And Sonia, if you have a chance to actually type over in the live chat section mm-hmm. of the conversation, I'd love for you to put your information there as well, yeah. just in case you were breaking up while you were talking, because sometimes there's a little break. But anybody who needs to excuse themselves or whatever, I just want to kind of wind down this part and say that we're going to have, what do you call it? The after party, because we're going to stop or pause the recording, but we're going to keep chatting here because, Sonia has been a great mentor in my life for many, many years, and this is the first time that I am chatting with her live. So as long as Sonia is willing to stay here with me, I am not letting her go. So I just want you guys to know.
Sounds like a hostage situation.
Huh?
Sounds like a hostage situation.
I'm not letting you go, Sonia. And that's until you say so, okay? So no hold up, no hostage situation. But I want anybody to know that if you need to go, I don't want to hold you.
Yeah,
but
no,
thank you
fine.
So much for being here on the Why Project. Again, we're here each and every Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, normally until 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. But we're going to keep this party going. So I'm going to stop the recording. But